It's Wednesday night, and we are in a study on predestination, but not like anybody else out there. People will call me and tell me, I agree with you on predestination, and they'll say, speak of the doctrines of grace. That means they are with Calvinist or with a Reformed Presbyterian church or Reformed Baptist church of some sort. Well, I go further than most men go in the doctrine of predestination. I go into God ordaining everything, including the sin, including the evil. God creating evil, He said He did. And I go into even the very thoughts of man ordained by God. You say, then that makes God a sinner. No, that makes God righteous. God can kill people for no reason, and He's righteous. You and I kill people for no reason. It's sin or it's murder. We cannot understand the God that we serve. We believe Him because He said it in His Word. A lot of things I do not understand. God said, your ways are not my ways. Well, let's read that before we go any further. Look over here in Isaiah, the 55th chapter. And the scripture will tell you, you cannot figure God out. His ways are past finding out. And that's because you can't think like He thinks. And He says here in chapter 55 of Isaiah, seek ye the Lord while He may be found. Call ye upon Him while He is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. Now, He's not talking about everybody in the world. He's not saying, not let the vessels of wrath forsake their way, because they're vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. When you study predestination, you got to study every facet of it. Most of the Calvinists and a lot of the Reformers believe that God's predestined His family, but He leaves the rest of the world to themselves. No, He plans not only their thoughts, but the timing of everything that they're going to do. Everything. Even their sin. And then He holds them accountable for it. Now, don't try to figure that out, because you can't. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous, let me put it this way. Let the wicked believer forsake his unrighteous way, and the unrighteous man his unrighteous thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord. See, He's not talking to unbelievers here. He's talking to believers. You can't return to the Lord if you're a vessel of wrath fitted to destruction. And He will have mercy on him and to our God, for He will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts. He says, you cannot think like I think. Trying to figure me out is a waste of your time. Believe me if I say something, and believe I'm righteous when I do it. God is righteous when He arranges everything. He arranged the thinking of the kings that attacked Israel, of Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. And these were some evil men. Now, Babylon, I can't figure out certain kings. I believe Nebuchadnezzar was a believer, because he's the one that said that God looks upon the earth and he does what He wills in the armies of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stop the hand of God doing what He wants to do. Nebuchadnezzar made that statement after he had been on his all fours for seven times, probably 7 months. And the Bible says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. The way you would do something is not the way I will do something. I'll kill somebody if I want to, but you cannot. I don't allow you to do that. God killed people from one end of the Bible to the other. He killed 70,000 when David numbered Israel, all because David numbered Israel. He killed 70,000 Israelites. He did this over and over. Then He would touch the mind and the hearts of Nebuchadnezzar and all the Babylonian kings, and He would touch the hearts of the Persian kings only, just three of them, he would touch the heart of Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes and give them decrees, put it in their mind, in their thinking, to tell Israel, go back and build your temple, go back and build your city. That's why Zechariah, the Lord said to Zechariah, it will not be by might nor by power, there in the fourth chapter of Zechariah, that you'll be released. It'll be by my spirit, saith the Lord, when I touch the mind of these three kings and say, here's your thinking, think this, and tell them they can go home. Everything is worked by God. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. The way you do something is not what I'll do. And my thoughts than your thoughts. You cannot think the way I think. Now, all through the Bible, we're going to see this. Men cannot. I'm trying to explain to you how God's thinking is not our thinking. I'm preaching on the seven churches of Asia, which are the seven candlesticks, on Sunday night. And I decided to make these right here. This is a picture of Turkey. Turkey was, the western end of Turkey was called Asia Minor. And I've got some markings on the, you can see it, I don't know if you can see it right there. It looks like a little tent with a little rope behind it to hold the tent up. This is the exact pattern of the Pleiades, or Pleiades, however you want to pronounce it. It's the exact pattern that comes out of the World Book Encyclopedia, right here. And what I did, I got a map, and then I've got a little article on it, but it doesn't tell you much on it. You won't get much out of World Book or out of Britannica or Americana. You won't get much. But you will get out of McClintock and Strong, it will tell you the Pleiades, it's called the Seven Sisters, and it's supposed to be seven stars. Now, the astronomers tell us there's more than seven stars in the Pleiades, but there's seven prominent stars, and it has the exact same pattern right here as the seven churches of Asia. And why would that be? Well, because when you get into Revelation, I should wait on this, Revelation, the second chapter, I'll just give you a little bit of it. You get into the seven churches, and they were all had a sin in them that they need to be perfected. And perfected, the common word in the New Testament is teleos. Every time the Bible says, be therefore perfect, or it speaks of perfection, teleotes. It's, huh? All right, let me move this over. All right, Mary's after me to write bigger. All right, and to show you what this has to do, each one of the churches has got some sin in it, and we'll be going back through that when we get back to Revelation. So, the word seven, Sheba in the Hebrew, means to perfect. And it comes from the word Shabuah. And Shabuah means to take an oath to God. And Shabuah comes from the word seven, or it means to seven one's self. And the church, these churches need to be sevened. The first church is Ephesus, and Paul said, and John the writer said, you need to be seven, because he said, you've left your first love, your first agape. You don't walk in God's commandments like you used to. So they need to be sevened, sevened up. Let's call it that, in that second chapter. Well, the Pleiades among the Jews, you can get this out of McClintock and Strong, they said the Pleiades, this was the rabbis. They said the Pleiades came out in the spring, and they were visible just before dawn in the spring. And that's when the crops bloomed, and they gave the Pleiades credit for bringing the crops up in the spring. That's why the Lord says to Job, can you bind the sweet influences of Pleiades and loose the bands of Orion? Orion took the sap down in the winter. That's what they said. That wasn't the point whether it did it or not. God used their cultural ideas to express something to them. He said, I can bind Pleiades influences where you'll not have any fruit or any crops in the spring. And that's what the churches had. They needed the fruit of the Spirit like they once had it. And that's the whole idea. The Pleiades, now the people at the World Book, they saw that they had the exact same floral pattern in the stars. And now here's the picture of the, it's like a little tent, has the same pattern as Pleiades. And the point I'm bringing out, tonight I'm talking about how God ordains everything, every action of every man, every word that comes from his mouth, the Bible says so. And every word that comes from God's mouth. I cannot understand how God can ordain sin, but he did. If he hadn't have picked up Adam and made him out of corrupt dust, if God had have made him out of formica or something like that, or plastic, he could have just gone and stood in the corner till the next day and say, all right, I will go out here and do my work and be a robot. But God has given us minds to think with, and then he arranges our thinking. Proof of that he arranges our thinking, is the word repent. Is the word metanoia. It means to be turned so you can think differently. To cause you to be turned and think differently. And you can't leave this alone. I can't say that to you because people are going to go to their concordances and say, I can't find this. But you can find it in the Bible. I had a Greek professor told me one time, he said, you'll find just as much truth in the context of Scripture as you will in the Greek definition. And the place where we will see to be turned and think differently is over here in Jeremiah. Let's go to Jeremiah. Jeremiah, look here in 32. Now this is the contextual definition that I use personally for repentance. But what goes along with this context definition is all the other verses that says you cannot repent on your own. Verses like, there's none good, there's none understands, and none seeks after God. Well, if you never seek after God and every man in the best state that he can be is altogether vanity, then you cannot repent yourself. You have to be turned. Well, that's what Jeremiah says here in Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, verse 18. I have surely heard Ephraim. Now, Ephraim, at this point, Jeremiah's writing sometime in the neighborhood of 597 to 586, because that's where he, B.C., because that's where southern Judah is destroyed. So he's mentioning the destruction of southern Judah here, but he's mentioning Ephraim, which is northern Israel, and they've already been destroyed. They've already been carried away into captivity in 722 B.C. by the Assyrians. I have surely heard Ephraim bemoaning himself because they're off in captivity. Thou hast chastised me, and I was chastised as a bullock, unaccustomed to the yoke. Now, the yoke of a kingdom. Yoke of a kingdom was the laws of a kingdom. That's what puts you in under some kind of rule. You can't just live the way you want to. He says, I was unaccustomed to the yoke. Turn thou me. God, you turn me, and I shall be turned. For thou art the Lord my God. Surely after I was turned, I repented. God has to turn us towards him because we can't turn ourselves. And after that, I was instructed. When I begin to repent, I listen to God's word, and I begin to listen to his instruction. Remember the word didache in the New Testament? That's one of the words instruction. Didache. It's the word doctrine or instruction. Then he says, I was instructed and I smote upon my thigh. That means to take an oath to God. If they were going to swear to God, they would smite their testicles. We get the word testament from that. And they were swearing upon their children, just like you'll hear in some mob movie. I swear upon my children. They would do that. And I smote my thigh. And when you are repentant, you are ashamed. He says, I was ashamed. If you've never been ashamed of your sin, you got a long way to go. Yea, even confounded, which means humiliated. You had to be humiliated, be caught in your sin, and be exposed by God, and then you get ashamed and you're humiliated because I did bear the reproach. To bear reproach means to willingly take the blame for the sin of your youth. If you've never taken the blame and you blamed everybody else, you got a problem. Now, that's why I will say that a person has to, they have to be ashamed, they have to take the blame. I have absolutely done that. God struck me down deathly ill in the hospital several times. Back in my 40s, where I thought I was going to die. And God only, it is the goodness of God, according to Paul in Romans, the 2nd chapter, there in the first few verses, it is the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. Goodness, Christatos, it is a form of many other words. Krio. This word Krio and Krio, those are the words anoint. And what are we anointed with? With the blood of Christ, with the truth, with the Holy Spirit, which is truth. And when we're anointed with the truth, that's because God is turning us around and causing us to understand the truth a little at a time as we learn. The point I was getting at about this right here, evidently God wanted these churches to have the exact pattern, that it has of the Pleiades. Those churches needed to be sevened, and the only way they could be perfected would be give up the sin that was besetting them. Do you realize the founders of these churches, what God had to do in manipulating their thinking? Now you walk over here, walk 10 miles this way, walk this way, 15 degrees this way, and stop over here, and I want you to found a city right here. He had to manipulate their thinking to that degree to have the Pleiades picture of the stars that need to be sevened, and these need to be sevened. We're not saying the Pleiades actually brought the fruit up in the spring. That's what the rabbis thought. That's what the McClintock and Strong will tell you. So when you've got the Pleiades, and the seven churches of Asia with the same pattern. God had to manipulate people's thinking. The men who founded these churches, God had to manipulate their minds to settle right where they did, didn't he? Now, that's the kind of thinking, that and the evil as well, that God will do in our lives to cause us to do the things he wants us to do. Now, I've got some verses. I just thought I'd throw that in. I'm going to pass these out Sunday night, and I'm still in the teaching on the Pleiades, but it seemed to mesh with what I'm talking right now. Everything that's going on, I'm going to give you a couple of verses I've already given you. Look over here in Proverbs 16, because these go with this. Proverbs 16 and verse 1. Now, the Bible says God manipulates man's thinking. Not only does he manipulate his thinking, he manipulates his actions, he manipulates the evil and the good. There's nothing that God is not doing that's going on in the world. And if we can come to that, we will be able to rest in God's Sabbath, like we've been saying. Sabbath does not mean seventh, it means rest. Sabbath, Shabbat in the Greek means rest. Over there in Hebrews, we were talking in that second chapter how that, let me read a little of it again. It's talking about Israel. I am trying as hard as I can to explain to you that everything that's going on, the good and the evil in your life, is ordained by God. All the evil is ordained in the lives of the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, so they can go to hell without any redemption. God has never planned these vessels of wrath, which is the majority of the world. Anytime I say that, majority of the world, something comes to my mind. The many and the few. Many are going into the Broadway that leads to destruction, and few are going into heaven through the narrow way. Few. Many and few. So anytime I speak of the people going to hell, I'm going to say that's the majority of the people. Now, look here in Hebrews, the scriptures, everything in our lives. Huh?
You said Proverbs.
Did I say Proverbs? Oh, Proverbs 16 and 1. Proverbs 16 and 1. The preparations of the heart in man. The heart was the place of understanding to the Jewish mind. The preparations of the heart in a man and the answer of his tongue is from the Lord. It matters not what it is, if it's good or if it's evil, if it's cursing God, comes from God. God's going to take those people, put it in front of their face, and say, now you have to go to hell because I've fitted you to go to be there. They are vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. They are natural brute beasts made or born to be just taken and destroyed. That's who these people are. There's no possible way for them to be saved. And there's no possible way for a person to be lost that God has convicted their heart of sin. You will improve on living less for yourself and living more for God as the years go by. That's just the way it is. You're not going to get out of it. They're not going to get into it. And this is a doctrine. This is more than just, well, God's predestined his people. Some of these people have something that they call, most of the Calvinists, most of the predestinationists have something they call free agency. And that's absolutely not true. They say life is like a big fishbowl or like an aquarium. And you can be a little fish in here. And you can be swimming around, and you can practice your free will in life. That's not true. But you can't get past these boundaries. The boundaries are there, but you're a wound up little fish. You can only do the will of God. That's all you can do. That's all anyone can do. You say, then I can go out and live the way I want to. Try it. I dare you to go out and try. If you're a believer, God will beat you with an inch of your life. You'll end up in the hospital with a heart attack and cancer. I've been there. You'll end up in the hospital. You'll end up angry and mean and mad as a believer. And you'll wake up one day and say, Lord, I give up. I give up. I can't stand this no more. And he'll say, okay, now you're going to behave yourself. Yes, sir.
Read verse 6. That's good.
Verse what?
6.
I didn't hear you.
6.
By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged. By the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. If you don't fear God, you're not going to leave the evil that you're in. And he says in verse 9, a man's heart devises his way, but the Lord is the one that directs his steps. You're going to make your plans, and it means nothing. It means something as far as your own personal self in your life, but it matters not. You're not going to get by with what you want. You'll start making plans like I did. I was going to be a world-famous singer, and I didn't get there. Had the voice, but I just didn't fit with the world. I didn't get along with them. I wasn't supposed to be there. Now, and people that knew me back then knew I wasn't supposed to be there. I won't tell that again. All right. Now, I want us to look at now at all the actions, the evil actions. Everything has been planned by God. Every action that man thinks of has been planned by God. The Bible says so. Go back over here to Acts 17. Acts 17. If he's planned everything, he has to plan everybody's thoughts to run into each other the way we do. I think about the people that come to Grace and Truth. If I hadn't made a right turn in Fort Worth, Texas in a 49 Ford in 1962, I wouldn't be here preaching right now if I hadn't made a right turn off of 28th Street going west onto Layton Avenue. Fred's life was different. He would have never heard me. He rode cycles with some of the bikers, big bikers. Gerald and Lily wouldn't be married. They'd have never met each other. A lot of the things and the people here that have hurt us and moved here from Thailand, you wouldn't be here if I hadn't have turned right in a 49 Ford. Like Dan.
I wouldn't be here either.
Mary wouldn't be here. I wouldn't have met her and married her. Dave wouldn't have seen me on TV in Dallas and used to be a heavy metal DJ. You wouldn't have seen me. I wouldn't have run into Gwen down here at Dillard's. She had loaded down with a bunch of packages and I'm saying, that lady needs some help. And I went over and said, let me help you carry these to your car. So I went out and helped her carry them to the car. People would not be here. This work wouldn't be done. The people watching out there would not be here if I hadn't turned right on a 49 Ford. Because I met a guy that took me in the music world, and nothing would have been the same. Right turns are very, God orchestrates that. And it's not that everything I went through was hunky-dory, and it don't mean everything I went through was righteous, because it wasn't. Now, look over here in Acts. And I want you to notice what it's saying here. It's not even saying what you'll think it's saying if you read it real fast. This is one of my favorite verses in all the Bible concerning the timing of everything. And man's thinking. There's not a verse I love more than this. Paul is over there he's over at Athens, out at Mars Hill, talking to a bunch of pagans. And he says here in verse 25, God is not worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life, all of his people, life and breath and all things. Well, he gives the whole world all things. And God hath made of one blood, that's Adam and Eve's blood, all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth. He's made all nations of men, made all their action, and he talks about, in the following line, he talks about the actions and the timing of all men, the timing of everything that they do, and hath determined the times. The timing of everything has been before appointed by God. The timing of that right turn, the timing of your clicking on the TV. God has determined all of it. And he's determined, the word determined, horizo, means there has been a boundary. Horizo is the word bound. And prohorizo is the word predestinate, to predetermine the boundary of horizo, or the boundary of light. He's predetermined the times, kairos, K-A-I-R-O-S. What this is saying, he's predetermined the timing of everything. He's predetermined the events, when they would happen, good and evil, everything. I make peace and create evil, I have the Lord do all these things. Man cannot even sin without God's sovereign will being involved. And he's determined the times before appointed. The timing of everything has been pro tasso. Tasso means an orderly arrangement. That's the same word. That's the same word when Paul said in Acts 13:48, when he was up there and preaching up there at Antioch, he was up here. When he said in Acts 13:48, he was up here at Antioch up here. There's two Antiochs, one down here, one up here, because Antiochus Epiphanes had been ruler of all of that part of the world at one time. So he was up here. And when the Gentiles rejected him up there, when the Jews rejected him, he went to the Gentiles and he made this statement. As many as were ordained tasso to eternal life believed. No one else believed, just those that were ordained, preordained before the foundation of the world. And then he says, they were before arranged, they were according to an orderly arrangement. It was God's orderly arrangement, and he arranged it all. And he says, he's arranged the timing, and it was before appointed, and the bounds of their habitation. Now, this is not talking about a people. Timing is called there. He says all of the hours and seconds and minutes on a clock were arranged for everything to happen. Now, this kind of predestination, most Calvinists do not believe. They think there's something involved in a man's will. And the Bible says we were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. That word will in John 1:10, thelema, means man does not determine, T-H-E-L-E-M-A. It means determination. Man's not born into the kingdom, and you do not do the actions in your life alone. If God wants you to do something evil, he turns Satan loose on you, just like he did Job, and gives Satan instructions. Don't touch his life. Don't do this. Don't do this. Now, we're going to let him go in this. I can't figure that out either. But Job said, the Lord has taken away from me my seven sons and three daughters and all my substance. And the Bible says, in all this Job sinned not nor charged God foolishly. The Bible says, when Job said, I did all the evil, he's right, and Satan was my servant in doing it. I love this. This is more than just God predestining his family. This is God preordaining everything in the world. Everything. And the boundary, there's a boundary, a horothesia, H-O-R-O-T-H-E-S-I-A. H-O-R-O-T-H-E-S-I-A. Thesia is the word tithemi, T-I-T-H-E-M-I. Tithemi means to lay out. Horos, the word horizo comes from horos. It means to bound. God has laid out the bounds of the habitation. Habitation, the bounds of the habitation of timing of all things. He's laid out the timing of everything. Then he says, oops, let me get this. The bounds of the habitation, horothesia, means to limit the boundary. That means timing. It has a housing. This is when you, can't go beyond that. That's where you got married. This is where you got divorced. Does God fix the timing of divorce? You bet your life He does. He fixes the timing of everything. And He is righteous and we are sinners. And He says, I predestined you to conform to My likeness, which is to be righteous, holy, godly. I go further with this than any other preacher I've ever heard. You say, then I can get by with my sin. No, you can't. The more of this you realize, the more God holds you accountable. You better not be listening to me, because the more you learn, the less you can get by with. That's the way it works. God is not going to let you live the way you want to live. He says, you're not your own. You're bought with a price, My blood, and you cannot live the way you want. Now go ahead and try if you think you can get by with it. When you belong to Him, He's going to change your thinking, change your mind. That makes us robots. Oh, yeah, wonderful. I'm sure glad God is in charge and not me. If I'm in charge, I mess things up. Every time I've tried to have my way, He says, you're not going to have that way. I'm going to straighten you out. I put you in that fleshly body so you will rebel against Me. And when I get through, you won't rebel anymore. I'll beat you. He scourges every son He receives that we can be partaker of His holiness. Scourge is a bloody whipping. It was the mastics. Mastigot was the word scourge. M-A-S-T-I-G-O-O. That is the word there in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Comes the word mastics. And a mastics was a little leather whip. They beat Jesus with this. They beat Him before they crucified Him. And it had little leather strips on the end of it. Sometimes had a little short handle. They just pulled out and ripped the hide out. Had leather strips with glass and bone all through there. And it would tear Him. And God says, I beat you that way. You misbehave. You go ahead and reinterpret this and say, I can live the way I want. Try it. I dare anybody to try it. It don't work with God. When you belong to Him, He said, you're not going to live the way you want. I am going to arrange your thinking. Have you ever seen anybody with a little kid and the kid wouldn't mind and they pull their belt off? I've seen my daddy do that and say, you'll listen to this. And God says, you'll listen to My scourge and I'll have an evil man pick it up and whip you with it. You want to try to live that way? Go ahead. He won't let you get by with it. He didn't let me. Now, so this is saying, well, I like that next verse, that they should seek the Lord. He's arranged everything so you'll seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after Him and find Him, though he be not far from every one of us. He's talking to us. For in Him we live and move and have our being, our very essence, our what we are, is all of God, good and evil. And He's going to save those that belong to Him, and He's going to refine them, bring them through the fire, make them conform to His likeness, and you'll quit wanting to argue with Him. That's what they were doing over there in the wilderness that we started to get back to. They could not enter in. This, we've been talking about this. When they were in the wilderness, Israel did nothing but argue with God all the way home. You have the Mediterranean Sea. You have Egypt here. They're coming out of Egypt. And they're coming across the, widens down here, the Red Sea. And they come across the Red Sea. And they come down here into the Sinai Peninsula. And they're going to, they're going home. And God, I remember when I was in Fort Worth and I was about 11 years old, this woman would chase her little boy up the street. And she would say, "I'm going to whip you all the way home." And she did. She'd get him two blocks up there and just whip him all the way. And God says, "I'm going to whip you all the way home." And He whipped Israel all through this wilderness for 40 years. Until He whipped all the unbelief out of them. There were certain people that did not believe God after He delivered them from Egypt, after He delivered them through the Red Sea, took the wheels of the chariots off the Pharaoh's armies, drowned them in the Red Sea. They got out here, and from one chapter to the other in Numbers, in the book of Numbers, they just want to fight God at every turn. Well, we can't whip these giants up here in the land of Anak, which now is called the Gaza Strip. During Jesus' day, it was the land of the Philistines, or during David's day. And they're coming through here and want to fight God all the way. That Sinai Strip there, that was a picture of the church in the world all of our lifetime. He has to whip us. And it'll be His will, and He'll take evil men and cut us down until our unbelief is gone. God took Israel through the wilderness, beat them all the way home, and when He got into Deuteronomy, this will really settle a lot of people's minds. When He got into Deuteronomy, He had killed all the unbelievers in Israel. He killed all the unbelief. He said, "I'm going to put you 40 years in the wilderness, and I'm going to kill off all the unbelievers that are here." These were exact people. The unbelief over here in our lives is the outer man. The outer man that wants to fight and argue. You're not fighting each other. You're fighting God. And the inner man is Christ in you. That's God. And He's saying, "This man here has to die." And we talked about Sunday night how it takes two witnesses to put anyone to death in Israel. And I'm going to get back into this Sunday night. And it takes the testimony of two witnesses in order to put self to death. Where's He going to get the two witnesses? Our conscience bears witness with His Spirit that we're sons of God. Conscience is the word sunidesis, S-U-N-E-I-D-E-S-I-S. This comes from ido, meaning to see, E-I-D-O. And soon means with. This takes the inner man over the years telling the outer man the same thing. God over here is going to tell Israel, "We're going to kill off all the unbelievers that argue with me going through the wilderness. And we're going to kill off," and God's going to demand that self, the outer man, vote with Him. And there's the two witnesses. bears witness, martyreo. Martyr is our word witness, and it means to die. We have to take our cross and die daily, but it takes a lot of fire and trials and persecution to convince that outer man, you have to give up self. Well, I'm just not going to do that out of the clear blue sky. I know you're not. You got all these things you want in life. I want this, I want that, I want her, I want him, I want that car, I want this job, I want to make all this money, I want some fame and fortune, I want recognition, I want to be special. You know, that is something that's present with all people. I want to be special, and you already are if you're elect. If you're elect, grace, charis means unmerited favor, God just picked out a certain few and made them his elect, his chosen. You're already special. You're special in the eyes of God. You don't have to be beautiful and handsome and have lots of money and be glib and a great personality. Usually, if you have all that, you're a vessel of wrath fitted to destruction. Because not many mighty, not many wise, not many noble in this world are called. And wise, mighty, and noble are people with lots of personality, and they got a lot on the ball, and they're out here, and they whatever they do does good, and you don't want that. Because Jesus said, my people are the poor, the brokenhearted, and the bruised. Now, all right, the Lord said, the boundary is all set. Everything, the boundary of everything is set. Look back over here in Job 14. I love these verses. I'm trying to talk to you about God arranging all the evil as well as the good. And he's arranging your thinking. If this is true, look here. And it is. This would go along with Acts, the 17th chapter. All right. Now, Job 14. I'm going to read this slow. I'm going to read the first verse, and then I'm going to read the fourth verse and the fifth verse. Man that is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. How's that for some words? We're here for a few days, and every day of our life is trouble, especially when we belong to God. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down real soon. James said, life is a vapor. In that fourth chapter, it's just here, wisp, and it's gone. It was just a few months ago that I was in my 20s. I think it was 6 months ago, something like that. It seems like it sometimes. They called me Little Jimmy Brown when I was in high school. There's Little Jimmy Brown. I was a little bitty guy, about 135 pounds, and 5'7", and you couldn't hardly use me as a paperweight. And I think of that, and I think, gosh, is that still me? No, life's gone by me, and it's about over. He fleeth as a shadow and doesn't keep on going. He's here temporarily. And dost thou open thine eyes upon such an one and bring me into judgment with thee? Who can bring a clean thing out of unclean? Not one. Seeing his days are determined. Karatz. It means bounded like a stake on a boundary line. His days are determined. Means to decide. Your days are decided. If you make a decision to run in front of a train, God preordained that before the foundation of the world. He said it's appointed unto man once to die. The word appointed means to preset. God has preset the death of everybody here, and everybody here has got it a day, a time, and exact seconds you're going to go into eternity. It's already set. You don't have anything to do with it. Oh, you may be driving down the street and look the wrong way, and while some car carries you off some cliff or something, but God set that too. You see, I am comforted to know that the timing of everything, that the evil and the good, and that He insists that I do righteous, and He's made my life miserable while I was being unrighteous. That's why He wants to be the one to turn you around. You're not going to be the one that turns yourself around. So it's not just the person that's preordained, it's everything He does and everything He goes through. Let me ask you this. If some guy's out here performing a robbery down here on Jefferson Street in Nashville, and there's probably several of them going on here since we've been here, at least two or three, could God stop that person from robbing that woman and then raping her if He wanted to? Could He? But why doesn't He? He don't want to. Now try to figure that out. You'll be figuring all night long, all next week. In fact, you'll be figuring until the day you die. You're not going to figure it out.
And it's for her good.
Huh?
And it's for their good.
And it's for our good if we're in the middle of it. It's not for their good. Everything that happens is for our good.
He's for their good?
Huh? It's not for the good of the bad people.
Maybe she's not bad.
Huh?
Well,
it's for the good of the elect. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them who are the called. If you get robbed and beat up and you're elect, that's for your good. Now, and he says, seeing his days, the number of days are determined. It's already been determined the day you're going to die and exact how many days you're going to live. The number of His months is with God. Thou hast appointed His bounds, Chok, Q-C-H-O-Q. God has appointed His bounds that He cannot pass beyond the boundary on everything, every action. You can't get by it. Now, we've read these verses before. Go back over here to Ecclesiastes. I didn't mean to get into all of this, but go to Ecclesiastes. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. I want you to think about these things. All through here it says, there is a time to be born, there in verse 2, time to die. It doesn't mean, that's not a general statement. Well, yes, we all know there's a time we're going to have to die, and we need to need to run red lights or speed because we might be helping God in getting His work done. God will let us do what we do, and He'll manipulate our minds to speed if He wants us dead that day, or to run in front of a train if He wants us to die that way. There's a time to be born, a time to die. There's actually a time to plant all kinds of crops. You don't plant everything at the same time. There's a time to plant, and farmers can tell you when that is. And a time to pluck up that which is planted. Mary plucked up something today that's been planted, and she went out on the patio and found a plant that had bugs all over it. She said, it's time to pluck that up because it was going to get onto the other plants. A time to break down, a time to build up. You can get into all kinds of things on this. When it's time to tear down, something has served its purpose. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, a time to dance. It's not talking about going to a nightclub. He's talking about rejoicing. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. There's actually a time if you're rebuilding something or if the floor's rotted in some place and you have to tear it out and rebuild it. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. What about all those verses over there in Paul's writings? Have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness. Refrain from embracing. we're to fellowship with those people. When the Bible says, forsake not the assembly of yourselves together, he's not saying assemble with anybody that goes to any kind of a church. Find some place where people believe the truth and embrace there. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend, tear something out. And a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak. Boy, I've learned a lot about that. A time to love and a time to hate. Lord, teach me to hate those that you hate with a perfect hatred, David said. A time of war and a time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given. God hath given this travail to men, to the sons of men, to be exercised by it. God says, I want you to go through this difficulty. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Everything is beautiful that is good for the believer, because this is to the believer. Let's go on down here. Let's go down here to verse 14. I know that whatsoever God doeth, and what is he doing? He's doing everything, isn't he? The thinking, the manipulating the thinking, the words from the mouth of a man comes from God. I don't believe anything is going on in the world that God is not doing, and he's going to cause us to live righteously and godly by whipping us and scourging us, because he put us in these bodies that couldn't keep from sinning. And then he exposed us to sin and says, now I'm going to bring you out of that. Is God guilty for anything that he did? No. He is the cause of everything. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Now, forever is the word olam. Olam means it always has been when it comes to God, and it always has, always will be. Well, is there a lot of thinking going on in there? If it always has been, it's all the wars, all the killings, all the fun, all the marriages, all the infidelities, everything. God has done it all. It is forever. And those of us that are his righteousness, he's going to pull us out of it and whip us and scourge us and beat us and cause us to get over ourselves. I can't fully explain this, because this is the sovereign will of a living God. I believe him if he says it. I don't try to figure it out. So all the planning and all the thinking and all the evil and all the good, if he works all things after the counsel of his own will in John, in Ephesians 1:11, and he does, then what have we got to complain about? I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever, and nothing can be put to it. Put to, gara, means to augment, add to it. It's all been done. It's from forever to forever, and it's every thought that we have, everything that we do. I'm not going to try to justify God like most preachers do by saying, well, God wouldn't do that. He's righteous. He does everything, and he's righteous. What you're trying to do is justify God according to your morality when you do that. He needs no justification from us. He is just. He is righteous. He's godly. He's holy. And we don't need to be arguing with the Bible when it says he works all things after the counsel of his own will. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. I did this paper on does God create evil. You have it all through the Bible. God killed 70,000 people in the 24th chapter of 2 Samuel. Because of David's sin, was God unrighteous to kill 70,000 innocent Israelites? No. The problem with these preachers, even the Calvinists, they want to somehow make God just. He is just. He doesn't need you to do it. And if he wants to put, let me ask you, did God have to invent something called sin? Did he have to do that? Well, you shouldn't even answer that, because we have no right to answer a question like that. God created sin, and he was righteous, and he never sinned. We have the law. I keep saying this. People think God is under the law. God wasn't under the law. The law was added because of transgressions. Galatians, the third chapter, says man transgressed against God, and so he made a law. Sin wasn't made for God. God is above the law. He killed people all through the Bible, didn't he? Constantly killing people just to kill them, just because it was part of his plan. You know what this ought to do? It ought to frighten people that God could do all this and be righteous, and we do it, and it's sin. And if we're one of his elect, he'll make us righteous by chastising us enough. I don't want the things I used to want. I don't want the sin I used to want. I just don't want it. I want to live righteously for the next 10, 12, 13 years and then die. Go be with the Lord. That's all I think about. I think about dying and going to be with Jesus. Now you can say, Jim, you don't really mean that. Yes, I do. I don't want to leave you here. I don't want to leave Mary here. I don't want to leave my grandkids here alone. I want them to grow up, live in truth, if I have anything to do with it, if God will allow me that. But as far as I have the desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better than this, it's got to be something better than this. I have a desire to depart and be with Christ, but Paul said it's more necessary for the church that I remain. And that's really the main reason I want to be here, is for you, so I can teach you these things. I want to put everything I can down through all these years that I've learned about Scripture, so I can leave them for the people to study. You can call that what you want to call it, but that's where my heart is. I believe my wife knows that. Now, where was I? I know that whatsoever God doeth, it always has been in the mind of God. And if it's always been in the mind of God, God has had to work all the thinking of every person that's ever lived. He had to work Adolf Hitler's thinking. Adolf Hitler was the last Assyrian. He was an Assyrian. Assyrians are Caucasians. He was the last Caucasian as a rod in God's hand to cut down Israel. And the Bible says, once I cut them down, they'll never leave again. Let me ask you something. You just stop and think of this. What is prophecy? Is it God foretelling the future as a seer? Or is it God prophecy? Is it God ordaining all the actions of all men coming to the end of time? How can there be an end of time if man has his own free will? It looks like the way things are going, man would have destroyed this a long time ago. It's amazing how much God says he'll do. Hold your place there and go over here to the book of Amos. Go to the book of Amos. And let me just use an illustration and show you about the actions of God. Amos. And look at the last chapter of Amos. And look here. Gosh, I don't want to read all of this. Speaking of Israel, verse 14. I will bring again the captivity of my people of Israel. Now, the book of Amos is written somewhere in the middle of the 8th century, somewhere around 787 B.C. Northern Israel has been carried captive. Southern Judah hasn't been carried captive yet. And Northern Israel has never come out of the captivity. And neither has Southern Judah. And God says, I will bring again the captivity of my people if I can get everybody to cooperate with my will and you don't go off and destroy Israel and don't end up with a big mess that I can't get my way and my will. I sure hope I can get all the people that are born to have intimate relations with the people that I'm planning on so I can come down to this day and time and have all of these things happen the way I'm prophesying they're going to happen. You think this is some difficulty with God? He's going to have to, every person that has a baby in the lineage of Christ, God has to stir the passions of that man and that woman to have that exact child. I asked several doctors, if it's another egg in the womb of the woman and another sperm in the man, will it be another person? They said, absolutely, it won't be that person. You realize that even the stirring of the passions of a man and woman, God's got to stir them because it's not the first sperm that hits the egg that goes into it and fertilizes it. This is how intricate God is. It may be the 18th sperm that breaks into the egg, and then no other can go in there. And that'll be that individual. God is arranging even the passions of a man and woman at night. Even in rape. And I don't like the preacher, but if he was a preacher of truth, it would be a lot different. James Robertson was the product of rape. He tells that story. You can't even have the person just because you have the sexual act, it doesn't mean it's going to be that person. God has to manipulate everything, passions. Everybody here is here because God orchestrated your parents and their parents and their parents' parents and their parents' parents and their all the way back to Adam and Eve. Nobody's doing anything on their own. If you ever come to this realization, one night maybe you'll be in your house and all of a sudden you'll find yourself face down on the floor saying, oh God, and you chose me. I can't believe you chose me. Because most of the people in the world, you didn't. You ordained them to be wrath, vessels of wrath fitted for destruction. God is not who people think He is. He's not Santa Claus or Captain Marvel or, if you remember him, I don't know if you remember him. He's not Superman. God is God. He's head of everything. Now, notice what he says after this. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be from now on, it always has been. Nothing can be added to it, nor taken from it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him. God is doing everything that always has been, it always will be. And you can't add or take away. People say, well, you can pray and change it. No, you can't. Prayer means to bow to the will of God. Prosukomai. You can't pray and change anything. Prayer changes nothing. Prayer bows to this eternal will that He's done. When you're in life and something bad happens and you don't like it, well, that's too bad, because you're not liking it is arguing with the will of God, will of a sovereign God. I'm afraid that's most of us along the way, isn't it? And God has taught me in these last 6 or 8 years to believe whatever comes. Just let it be. And if you can understand that, prayer changes nothing. In prayer, prosukomai is the word. That's the only word in the New Testament Greek. You got a verb and a noun form, prosuke. And that's the word pray. are praying. This is prayer. This is the noun. This is the verb. And it comes from pros, meaning toward, and uk, meaning to will. It means to will towards the will of another. It means to bow to this will of everything he's doing, changing your thinking, changing everything, manipulating your mind, manipulating your car as you go down the road. Well, I thought that was me steering. It is, but it's God. Now, figure that out. God really is God. Now, look at this. Go and look at this. Look at verse 15. What it all says, that men should fear before God. If you realize this, you'll start being afraid of God and who he is. Verse 15. That which hath been is going on now. That which hath been in the mind of God that cannot be changed is happening right now. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be, he's declared the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, everything that's not yet done by everybody's thinking, by all of their movements, by their anger, by their gentleness, by whatever character they have, he's determined all of that. That makes us a puzzle, like a bunch of little army men on the floor in front of a little kid. That's right. Yes, sirree, that's right. What that needs to do in our lives is humble us to the point that we say, God, you really are God. I'm going to start living for you and stop my fighting and stop trying to have my way about anything. And that's hard to get out of.
Read verse 11.
All right. Mary wants to read 11. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he has set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work of God maketh the from the beginning to the end. Nobody can figure it out. But we can figure it out that he has to change our thinking, and he gave us the twisted thinking to begin with in this fleshly body we're in. Well, then, you can live the way you want. Oh, no, you cannot. He's fixed that too. And then he says down here, that which hath been is now, that which is to be has already been in the mind of God from before the foundation of the world. And God requireth that which has been in his mind in the past. He requireth what he has known from before the world began. You see, I can't understand that. Can you understand where God started? Can you understand if he never had begun, if he never had a beginning, but he's always been? Can you understand that? I can't. The problem with a lot of people, they try to figure out God's words to fit their morality. They try to take this book, well, it's got to fit into an American way of thinking. No, it doesn't. It's not going to fit into an American way of thinking. Now, all these verses in this paper I did this paper, Does God Create Evil? All through it, it's got God creating all the evil all through this. God has planned everything ahead of time, and he said, what I'm telling you, go back over here to Isaiah, the 42nd chapter. Isaiah 42nd chapter. God says, I've planned everything. Then I've told you beforehand that it's going to happen and when it's going to happen. Do you think the 70 weeks of Daniel is going to finish happening? If God can get everybody to do what he wants them to do? No. He's going to get everybody to do what he wants them to do, including the evil. Look here. How much time do I have, Mike?
19.
Let's go over here. I'm going to give you a couple of verses. Now look here in, let me just read you some verses. Isaiah 42. You don't have any fear of God if you think you can live the way you want and you're a believer. After God whips you thoroughly like he's done me, and at 77 you've had a lot of whippings in your life. I didn't think I was going to live through from about 30 to 60. I thought, I ain't going to live. I can't get through this. About a 30-year period, I was sick constantly to the point of death. Now here in Isaiah 42. All right. Look at verse 8. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory will I not give to another. If you get up on a stage to take glory and credit for singing gospel songs, God says, I'm not in it. You're getting the glory, and I don't want any part of your stage work. If you trying to be in some business out here to buy big fancy cars and houses and things, God says, I'm not in it. Neither my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things are come to pass. Former means the ones at first, the ones that were in the beginning. Former is, if you got a beginning and you got an ending, this is the latter things. Here's the former things. He says, now, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare before they spring forth. I tell you of them. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen, what kings I'm going to raise up, who I'm going to destroy. I'm going to tell you about the end of time. I'm going to tell you about, I'm going to have these prophets come and prophesy all about the end of time. When you read Matthew, the 24th chapter, God goes through the history of time and tells you things are going to happen. There's going to be wars and rumors of war, nation rise against nation. And all of this is going to happen. And he says, Jerusalem will be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentile rule is fulfilled. Well, Jerusalem was trodden down in 586 B.C., and they didn't cease to be trodden down. Jerusalem didn't cease to be trodden until May 14th, 1948. Do you think God was ordaining? Do you think he was in charge all that time, 2,600 years, retaining Jerusalem when they should have disappeared eons ago when the whole world was attacking them? Do you think that was in the plan of God? How could God say what's going to happen up here and we're way back here? Because he's planned it all. You see, this is a form of predestination. Most of your predestinationists don't want. Because that is out of our realm of thinking the way God is saying this. He says here in the 46th chapter of Isaiah. Isaiah 48. Verse 5. I have declared the former things from the beginning. And they went forth out of my mouth, and I showed them.
What chapter?
Chapter 48 of Isaiah. Verse
3.
Verse 3. I have declared the former things from the beginning. The things that did happen, I've declared them from the beginning before they happened. And they went forth out of my mouth, and I showed them. I did them suddenly, and they came to pass. Because I knew that thou art obstinate, and thy neck is an iron sinew, and thy brow brass. I have even from the beginning declared it to thee. Before it came to pass, I showed it thee, lest thou shouldst say, if I hadn't have told you it was going to happen ahead of time, according to my word, you would say, my graven image and my molten image have commanded these things to come to pass. God said, I told you beforehand what is going to happen. Well, how could he do that without ranging people's thinking, without ranging evil? He couldn't do that, could he? You can take anywhere you've got prophecy. You can go over here to, you can go over to Ezekiel. And go to Ezekiel. Ezekiel 37. 30. I could go to 37. He talks about he's going to bring Israel back. He's going to bring out the Valley of Dry Bones. They were dead a long time. He's actually prophesying the end of time when he brings back Judah and Jerusalem, Judah and Israel, northern Israel, back into one nation. Oh, that hasn't even started to happen till the 20th century when Israel became a nation. Is God in control of all of that? Is he ordaining all of it? Was he ordaining World War II when Hitler, the last evil Assyrian, rose up and slaughtered 6 million Jews at God's order? And after that, they haven't been slaughtered anymore. God's doing, all prophecy is about, it's pre-written history. And who is the writer? God himself. I can't see how a preacher can preach prophecy and say, and the man of sin, the way we can stop him. You can't stop the man of sin. That stupid movie, The Omen, and they're going to go out there and kill, and the man of sin rises up in the government and becomes ambassador to England, and that's the best he gets there, and this is going to be the ruler of the world. Probably head of the, say, our Secretary General of the United Nations, or something equivalent to that. Not going to be ambassador to Britain, and they were trying to kill the Antichrist. They called him Antichrist. He was a man of sin. But they tried to kill the Antichrist all through that movie. Is that dumb? You're going to kill the Antichrist. And everything that God prophesied is not going to be able to come to pass because you kill the Antichrist. That's people who make those kind of movies, they ought to be, they deserve a good beating for fooling people like that. Now here in Ezekiel, the 38th chapter, are all these prophecies that will come to pass? Look here in verse 2. Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, O Gog, chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. Meshach and Tubal is in this area right here. Of chief prince of Meshach and Tubal would be the chief prince of the world beast system. And he says that all these nations are going to attack Israel as one conglomerate. That's never happened before. How could God say that? Is he going to arrange it? Or is he using his crystal ball to look ahead in the future, look at man's will and see what he's going to do? No. And then he talks about all the people he's going to bring against Israel in the future from this date. Ezekiel is in the captivity about 596 to 594 BC. These peoples have never attacked Israel as a whole. When you look at, he's talking about these armies, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields. That's in verse 4. And all of them handling swords. Persia, which is Iran, Ethiopia, which is below Egypt, Libya. He names all of these nations around here. Here's Libya right down here, just right below this. And he names all of these nations that have never attacked Israel as one unit before. He names Persia, Ethiopia, Libya, Gomer. Gomer is right up there by the Black Sea, right in this area right here. All of this, and how could Ezekiel name all these things that's going to happen without God controlling it? You understand what I'm saying? God has to be, this is on God's agenda for this to happen in the future. It's God's word. It's God's judgment. But because God is doing it, does that mean he's pleased with the sin of these people? No. He causes them to sin, and then he's going to hold them accountable without redeeming them. He talks about Gomer, Togarma, which is right there in the middle of Turkey, of the north quarters and all his bands. And he's going in here, he's talking about all of the people that's around Israel is going to attack them as one complete whole. That's never happened before. I preach on this chapter to teach the end of time when all these people gather around to attack Israel. And it's never happened. How does God know to tell Ezekiel that? He's got it planned. He's going to manipulate everybody's mind, their thinking, the whole works. Look back at the 36th chapter. After God scatters them here in Ezekiel, the 36th chapter. Now look at all the wills and the shalls. If God says, I will, that means that's in the future, and I'm going to do this. It's not going to be, well, if I can get the people to be in the right place at the right time. He's going to cause their minds to think that they need to be there in that position to do this attacking. In northern Israel has been carried away captive. Ezekiel is in the captivity already in Babylon around 596, and Israel won't be destroyed until 586 B.C. And here's what God says he's going to do. O ye mountains of Israel, verse 8. The mountains of Israel were Zion and Mount Moriah, where Jerusalem sat. O ye mountains of Israel, he's calling the people the mountains of Israel over in Babylon. Just look at the wills and shalls. Verse 9, for behold, I am for you, and I will turn unto you, and ye shall be tilled and sown. I will multiply men upon you. This is not if you don't disappear in antiquity. I will do this. Look down here in verse 11. I will multiply upon you man and beast, but they're in captivity and don't look like they have any hope. I will settle you after your old estates. I will bring you back. And look in your concordance and look up the word gather. I will gather you from whence I have scattered you. Is that going to be if God can get the people to think the way he wants them to? Yes. And can he do that? Yes. Verse 11, I will do better unto you than at your beginning. Verse 12, yea, I will cause men to walk upon you again. And going down here to, he said, I scattered them among the heathen in verse 19, but I will do these other things. I will bring you back. In verse 24, or verse 23, I will sanctify my great name. Verse 24, I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of the countries. I will bring you into your own land. And he's writing that somewhere around 596, and Israel's got to go into captivity and be there 2,600 years. He's talking way in the future. I will do this. If God's going to do it, he's going to have to manipulate a whole lot of thinking, isn't he? And a whole lot of evil. Then I will sprinkle clean water upon you. That's living water. And all of your idols will I cleanse. I will cleanse you. Verse 26, and a new heart will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away your stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. This is not something he has done. He said, this is what I'm going to do with all these wars that's going to come. I'm going to manipulate the wars, their minds. I'm going to manipulate Adolf Hitler's mind. I'm going to manipulate the Nazis. I'm going to manipulate the fascists with Mussolini. All these people. I'm going to have all these wars all over the world. I'm going to manipulate the minds of the Arabs, of the Muslims. And it's all going to happen according to my will. I will put my spirit within you. That's talking about the church, isn't it? and cause you, I will cause you to walk in my statutes. They never had yet, not to this point, never had. And ye shall dwell in the land that I gave your fathers. How can Ezekiel believe that when he's over here in Babylon in captivity and they look like they have no hope? Daniel comes after Ezekiel and Daniel cries out in the ninth chapter of Daniel, how long are we going to be here, Lord? And he gives him the 70 weeks of Daniel. This is all future. God's got to do a lot of manipulating of thinking and evil and good and the whole thing. I will be your God. I will, verse 29, also save you from all your uncleanness. I will call for the corn and will increase it and lay no famine upon you long way in the future. This is not stuff he's done. He said, I will do it. What does he have to do with men's minds to get all this to come to pass? A whole lot of wars, a whole lot of evil thinking, a whole lot of good thinking, a whole lot of righteousness, a whole lot of unrighteousness. God's doing everything. I will multiply the fruit of the tree. Verse 31, then shall ye remember your evil ways. There's going to come a time where you will repent, Israel. And he says in verse 33, I shall have cleansed you from all your iniquities. I will cause you to dwell in the city. I will call this future perfect tense. In verse 35, they shall say, this land that was desolate has become like a Garden of Eden. That has never happened yet until the 20th century. They used to call Israel a wasteland when I was in elementary school in the 1940s. I remember the teacher saying that. And they discovered since then that it's one of the richest soils upon the face of the earth. Well, see, all this is prophesied. This prophecy took place back 2,500 years ago, nearly 2,600 years ago. All these wills and shalls, Spurgeon quoted these and he said, all of God's wills and shalls shall come to pass. Everything's going to come to pass. That's prophecy. And then I like this, verse 36, then the heathen that are left round about you shall know that I, the Lord, build the ruined places and planted that was desolate. I, the Lord, has spoken it, and I will do it. That word spoken, dabar, means to arrange. I have arranged it in my mind, and it's going to happen. But he's got to manipulate a lot of evil for that to happen, doesn't he? I don't believe anything is going on. It's just that's not the will of God. We as human beings have a hard time settling in that God's doing what he wants with our lives. I don't care what it is. If he's given us bronchitis like me, high blood pressure like Mary, losing a leg like Rusty, it's the will of God. You argue with it, and you're arguing with God's sovereign will. I'm out of time. I just began to think this week, and all the evil that God brought on Israel out there in the desert, that was to kill off all the unbelief, just like he's killing off all unbelief. If you live long enough, you won't fret over it. If you can live as long as Milton, you won't think, what's going on in my life? Let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. What a God you are to be able to do everything you want to do. It's just, that's not even amazing if we believe that you're God. But it frightens us. We don't even know how to think about you. We can't think the way you think. Lord, help us in all that we do. Cause us to grow in truth. We'll give you praise for everything. Lead us to your elect. Fight our battles in Christ's name, amen. If we keep saying this enough, maybe we'll get a hold of it. If you live long enough, you'll get over yourself. You'll get over the outer man.
Intense.
Is that intense? Is that N-T-E-N-T-S?
I mean,
Dave, bye.
Because the words you say,
huh?
The words you say, it's the words I think is kind of like, oh God.
Well, I've never met anybody that thinks that way.
Well, when I'm,
believes that God is doing everything, including the people, manipulating people's thinking for evil. Huh?
He's got it because it don't make no sense any other way. That's the only conclusion I can come.
That's hard to get a hold of. If a man will ever get a hold of it, he'll quit fretting about anything.
Thanks a lot.
Huh?
Thanks a lot.
That's hard to get a hold of it.
Man, you were on tonight.
Huh?
You were on tonight.
Well, we have to learn that if he says, I make peace and create evil, and I'll turn you. He said, I'll take Gog and turn the, put hooks in their jaws and turn them back. I'll make them think differently.
When you said that, you know, that was going on, that was 2,600 years ago, and all the minds that had to be...